हेलो एवरीवन एंड वेलकम बैक टू दी सेशंस ऑन स्ट्रैटेजिक फाइनेंशियल मैनेजमेंट। फ्रेंड्स, दीज आर द रिविजनरी क्लासेस ऑन स्ट्रैटेजिक फाइनेंशियल मैनेजमेंट एंड वी आर इनटू द टॉपिक फॉरेक्स रिस्क मैनेजमेंट। एंड एज यू कैन सी ऑन द स्क्रीन, वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट हेजिंग थ्रू फॉरवर्ड कवर और हेजिंग थ्रू फॉरवर्ड कॉन्ट्रैक्ट। एंड यू नो वॉट इज अ फॉरवर्ड कॉन्ट्रैक्ट, वी हैव लर्नड दैट इन डेरिवेटिव्स। सो when a forward contract has an underlying as a currency, it becomes a forward exchange contract. So generally an entity who is importer or exporter would take a forward cover, that is would enter into a forward exchange contract for hedging the foreign exchange risk. Now what happens typically when you take a forward cover, that means when you already enter into a forward exchange contract, the point is it necessary that you are going to honor the contract? The answer to that question is we don't know as of now, because with the changes of situations and circumstances, it may so happen that you are not able to honor the forward contract. Let me give you one simple example. You have made an import of $1 lakh and the payment is due after 6 months. So what you have done for protecting yourself from the foreign exchange rate fluctuations, you have entered into a forward exchange contract to buy $1 lakh, and at the contracted price of ₹70 per USD. If you have entered into a contract to purchase USD after 6 months, as the time passes out, when you near the maturity of the contract, say when you land up at the end of the contract term, you have arrived at the date of settlement and you find that you are not able to arrange that much funds to honor your forward contract. In such case, what you will have to do is you will have to cancel your forward contract. The forward exchange contract that you have entered into earlier, now you will have to cancel the forward exchange contract. And of course, there will be charges that you will have to pay to the authorized dealer or to the bank, because the contract has been cancelled from your end. So there may be a fixed charge of cancellation fixed by the authorized dealer or banker as a minimum charge, and the charge for cancellation could also include the variable charge depending upon the market rates. So how this would work, let me explain that. So suppose I am an importer company and I have made an import. I have to make the payment after 6 months and that amount is $1 lakh. In that case, if I have entered into a forward exchange contract and the forward exchange contract allows me to buy $1 lakh at price of ₹70 per dollar, and of course the contract is to be settled after 6 months. At end of 6 months, I find that I don't have enough money to honor the contract. I will have no choice but to cancel the contract. The question is, what is the right approach to cancel the contract? How would you cancel the contract? Point is simple. You will have to take a reverse position. Taking a reverse position means what? When you enter into a contract to buy, to square off that contract, you will have to now take a new contract to sell the same underlying. In other words, original contract that was taken by me was to buy $1 lakh. Now I have to enter into a new contract to sell USD. And original contract was a 6 month buy forward. Because 6 months have already got over and you have already arrived at the date of settlement and you are not going to honor the contract and you have to cancel the contract, you will have to take a reverse position, that is you have to enter into a contract to sell, and selling dollars at the same date would require a sell spot transaction. So the original buy forward contract is cancelled at the maturity date by sell spot. Difference between the rates of buy forward and sell spot will be considered as the amount of cancellation charges payable. In other words, suppose I have agreed to purchase dollars at 70, and at the spot on the maturity, if I have to sell the same dollars at a lower price, maybe say 69, what will happen? I am purchasing dollars at 70 and selling the same at 69. Rupee 1 per dollar will be my loss or a charge towards cancellation. $1 lakh multiplied by rupees 1 per dollar, that is the amount of cancellation charges that bank will recover immediately from me the moment the contract is cancelled. Sometimes in this regard, if the rates given are interbank rates, don't forget to adjust the margin, because what will happen, interbank forex rates are such rates at which one bank can buy or sell from other bank. That means among the dealers, the rate that would prevail for them to transact or from their viewpoint to exchange currencies among themselves, that is interbank rate. When bank is quoting a rate to a customer who could be an importer or exporter, that rate has to be a properly adjusted rate, and that adjustment with respect to margins you have to make. So take precaution when you are dealing with forward contract and cancellation, and the question is informing you the rates which are interbank rates. Additionally, just one thing you have to do is adjust the margin. And as in the earlier class, we have learnt the concept where if there is a bid and ask rate, a two-way quote given, the bank margin, how will you consider? From the bid, you are going to subtract the margin, and to the ask, you are going to add the margin. That is how you will convert an interbank rate to a rate that will be quoted by the dealer to its customer, that would be either an importer or an exporter. So friends, whatever I have theoretically discussed, I will give you some small examples for you to get much clarity on this concept. Once you get clarity, we will take up full-fledged calculative examples, which are important questions that have been asked in past examination or some other miscellaneous type of questions as well. So let us begin with some examples followed by questions. So let us begin with example number one. Original forward contract was entered on 1/10/2017. So this is the date on which the original contract was entered. Now, what was the original contract for? Original contract was for selling USD on 31/12/2017. Now, you would want to cancel this contract. Okay. So, for cancelling the original contract on 31/12/2017, what action would you follow? So, first thing first, the original contract was to sell USD. To cancel this contract, you have to take the reverse position. That means you have to buy USD, correct? So, the reason behind this is very simple. The original contract is for selling USD. The opposite position, the reverse position, will be by buying USD. But this will be effective only when the date on which you buy USD must be the same date on which you have agreed to sell. Then only your contracts will cross cancel each other. Now look into one thing. This was the date of settlement, 31/12/2017, and you have already arrived at that date. That means the type of contract that you enter into on 31/12/2017 for reversing the position, that is by buying USD, it must be a spot contract. The reason for this spot contract is the date on which the original contract was due for settlement, you have already arrived at that same date. As a result, what you need to do is to spot buy USD. So, buying spot is the action that you have performed on 31/12/2017 to cancel this original contract. So, friends, what I am trying to tell you is buy spot. These are the set of actions, right? Why buy? Opposite of sell is buy. And why spot? Because the date on which you are cancelling the contract is the date on which the original contract was due for settlement. So friends, I would want you to note down this example and then I take you ahead. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this. Let us take another example. Original forward contract again entered on 1/10/2017. This contract was to buy USD on 31/12/2017. for cancelling the original contract on 31/12/2017, what action would you follow up? So, as I told you, the original contract is to buy USD. So, to reverse the position, obviously you have to sell USD. So, for cancelling the original contract, first thing what you should consider is selling USD. And as I have mentioned, why sell USD? Because the original contract was to buy USD. You have to take a reverse position. That is why sell USD. Now, other thing that you need to plan is the date on which you should sell this USD must be the same date on which you have agreed to buy. That means the same date on which the original contract settlement was due. In other words, you must sell USD on this same date. Look at one thing, you have already arrived at that date. So obviously, to make this happen, you have to sell USD at spot. Why? Because you have already arrived at that date. Today is 31/12/2017 and the contract is to be settled on the same date. So your action has to be planned on the same date, and that is why your action plan will be sell USD at spot for cancelling this original contract. So note down this example as well, and then I take you ahead. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this example. Let us move ahead and take up another example. Original forward contract again entered on 1/10/2017. This was to buy USD on 31/12/2017. Now, for cancelling the original contract, look into this date on 31/10/2017. First thing what you find in this example different is that we have not arrived at the settlement date yet. We are still, you know, way ahead of the settlement date. We have 2 months gap between the date of cancellation and the settlement date. So, what you need to follow now? Original contract was to buy USD. So, first thing, to cancel this contract, you must agree to sell USD, correct? Opposite of buy will be sell. That is one thing for sure. Second thing, you must sell USD on the same date when you are supposed to buy USD as per the original contract. Then only the new contract will cross cancel this old one. So, this original contract was due for settlement on 31/12/2017. But you have not arrived at that date yet. You have a 2 month time gap. So, on 31/10/2017, you must enter into the contract to sell USD, but this time not at spot but at 2 month forward. Why 2 month forward? Look into one thing. Your original contract was due for settlement on 31/12/2017 and today it is not 31/12/2017. It is still 31/10/2017, 2 months yet to go for arriving at the due date or settlement date. So, considering this date, you cannot go for sell USD at spot, but you must sell USD at 2 months forward. Whenever you are planning something like this, ensure one reconciliation. Original contract was entered on 1/10/2017 to buy USD on this date. The new contract you are entering into on 31/10/2017 to sell USD 2 months forward. So, the settlement date of this new contract will be matching with this. When this contract settlement date is matching with the settlement date of the original contract, and this was originally to buy USD and the new contract is to sell USD, then only these two contracts can cross cancel against each other. So, friends, I would want you to note down even this example and then we move ahead. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this. Let us take one last example. Now, in this example, the original forward contract was entered into on 1/10/2017 to sell USD on 31/12/2017. And you are now having an objective for cancelling the original contract, but today, the given date is 31/10/2017. That means you are again trying to cancel the contract before its due date, before its maturity. So, what you have to do, just think again. The original contract was to sell USD, To cancel that, you must enter into a contract to buy USD. Opposite of sell will be buy. Now, next thing, which date you should buy USD? Obviously, same date on which you were supposed to sell USD. That means you must buy USD on 31/12/2017. However, today it is 31/10/2017. That means 2 months yet to go for arriving at this settlement date. So obviously, on 31/10/2017, you cannot buy USD at spot. It will not solve the purpose. You must buy in such a way that the settlement of this buy USD contract should be due on this date. And for that, there is a 2 month lag. As a result, you will buy USD 2 months forward. Why 2 months forward? Because look into this current date. It is not yet the same date which is matching with the original contract due date. As a result, the time lag is 2 months. So you should enter into a contract to buy USD 2 months forward. As I mentioned in the earlier example, look into the outcome of both the forward exchange contracts. Now you have the original contract was to sell USD on 31/12/2017, and the new contract is entered into on this date, which is a 2 month forward contract. So obviously, the new contract settlement date will be 31/10/2017 plus 2 months, that is 31/12/2017. Original contract was to sell and the new contract is to buy. With the same due dates or same settlement dates of both these contracts, obviously they will be eligible to cancel against each other because one is to sell and another is to buy. So note down this example as well and then we move ahead. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this. Let us move ahead and take up concept number 23, that is rollover and cancellation on maturity. Let me tell you one thing very well. Once you have understood how to cancel a contract, then anything near around like rollover, etc., will be easily manageable. With the same logic that you have learned, you have to apply it over here also. So let us take question number 43 to understand this concept. Let us read this question. X Limited purchased an asset for $1 lakh on 1/10/2009. The exchange rate on that date is $1 equals to rupees 44 to rupees 44.60. The amount was to be settled after 3 months, that is on 31/12/2009. On 1/10/2009, the forward rate available was $1 equals to rupees 44 to rupees 45 for 3 months. X Limited entered into this forward exchange contract. On 31/12/2009, X Limited is unable to honor the contract and requires an extension for 2 months, and the expected date of settlement shall be 28/2/2010. The spot rate on 31/12/2009 was $1 equals to rupees 44.60 to rupees 45.30, and on the same date the forward rate available for 2 months was $1 equals to rupees 45 to rupees 45.70. X Limited decides to roll over this forward exchange contract on 31/12/2009. Determine the following action to be taken on 31/12/2009 and net additional cost for rollover. So friends, what we generally do is we would first plan the entire solution and then put up the solution on screen. So look into this question first. It is a case of an importer, correct? X Limited has made a purchase of $1 lakh, and so the moment the company is hedging its foreign exchange risk of payment of this $1 lakh, the spot exchange rate is not relevant. What is important is the 3 month forward rate that the company has considered for hedging its dollar liability. That means you should consider the 3 month forward ask rate for this purpose. In simple words, the company has entered into a contract to buy $1 lakh at rupees 45. So its final obligation is rupees 45 lakhs payable after 3 months, that is payable on 31/12/2009. But on that date, the company is unable to honor the contract. That means it will have to first of all cancel the original contract. to cancel the original contract, you know what you have to do. First of all, the original contract was to buy US dollar. So to cancel the contract, you must sell US dollar. Because you have already arrived at that date, you must make the sell as a sell spot. Now for further extension of 2 months, you simply have to enter into a new forward exchange contract, and that will be a 2 month forward rate given to you as 45 to 45.7. In the new forward contract, you again have to buy US dollar, so it will be ask rate again that you will consider, that is 45.70. So friends, finally, if you look into what has happened on 31/12/2009, you are taking up two actions. Number one, selling dollars at spot rate of 44.60 and buying dollars at a forward rate of 45.70. So ideally, difference between 44.60 and 45.70 is going to create a loss for you. But we will split this loss into two parts. One is the cost of cancellation that you will have to pay upfront, and one will be the amount that you will have to bear as additional liability, because as per the original contract, you were supposed to buy dollars at 45. Now, as per the new contract, you will be buying dollars at 45.70. So your payable amount has increased substantially, and that will be an additional cost. So friends, let us start putting up the solution. Please pay attention. Original liability as per the forward exchange contract taken on 1/10/2009 was rupees 45 lakhs. On 31/12/2009, the company is unable to meet its obligation of paying rupees 45 lakhs and buying dollar 1 lakh. Therefore, it has to take a reverse position, that is to sell dollar 1 lakh at prevailing spot rate on 31/12/2009. So basically, as I told you, on 31/12/2009, what you need to do is sell spot. So do one thing, first write up this much and then I take you ahead. Alright friends, let us move ahead in the solution. So what we do next is, doing so, it agrees to sell such amount of dollar 1 lakh at 44.60, which it has agreed to buy at 45 rupees per dollar. Therefore, the resulting loss is 40,000. So basically, you have agreed to buy originally US dollar at rupees 45 per dollar. And now to cancel the contract, you are supposed to sell spot US dollar at 44.60. So basically, this calculation of rupees 40,000 is the cost of cancellation. Now, for extension of this contract, as I have mentioned, you have to enter into a new contract. So on the same date, that is on 31/12/2009, company can enter into a new forward contract to buy dollar 1 lakh on 28/2/2010, that is buy forward. The contracted forward rate is rupees 45.70. Before I take you ahead, please write up this much. Alright friends, let us move ahead in the solution. So what do you find further? With this arrangement, the company's liability increases from 45 lakhs to 45,70,000. I have already explained you why it is like this. Originally, you were supposed to pay rupees 45 lakhs as per the original forward contract to buy 1 lakh US dollar. Because you could not honor that contract, now you have to buy at a higher rate. So your liability increases by how much? 70,000 rupees, correct? So how would you calculate the cost of cancellation? We have discussed that earlier. This was the cost of cancellation. And increase in the amount of obligation is by 70,000. That is difference between these two amounts. So the overall cost that the company had to incur, 40,000 will be paid to the bank upfront, and 70,000 will be the increase in its liability. Finally, the additional cost of rollover comes to 1,10,000. So note down this as well, and that will be end of the solution. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this. Now one important thing before I put an end to this solution. Look into one thing. The total amount of additional cost 1,10,000 is basically split into two parts, 40,000 and 70,000. on purpose, we must calculate both of these separately. 40,000 was typically the cost of cancellation. That means you pay 40,000 to the bank and your contract, the original contract, gets cancelled out. Now, this 70,000 was basically your choice, correct? You wanted to extend the period of hedge and therefore you have agreed to bear this additional cost. Just imagine what would have happened if the company simply pays 40,000 and cancels the original contract. It will not be called as rollover, it will be not be called as extension, it will simply be called as cancellation. In such case, the cost of cancellation would have been only 40,000. But in that case, the company will be exposing itself to foreign exchange rate fluctuation for the extended period of 2 months. So the choice now is either to cover that 2 months by incurring extra 70,000 or keep your exposure open, and anything can happen in that case after 2 months. So it is this 40,000 cost you have to incur without failure. This 70,000 is as per your choice. You want to further hedge, bear this extra cost of 70,000 and keep yourself secured. You don't want to bear this extra cost, keep your exposure open. Maybe you don't have to bear this cost at all, but then that is a risk. It may be something even more than 70,000 that you might pay at the end on settlement. So let me give you that also by way of a note. So note down that, though that note is not part of the solution, but for your understanding, please write up this note. The strategy formulated by the company on 31/12/2009 was sell spot and buy forward. This results into rollover of the contract by 2 months. However, if the action taken on 31/12/2009 is only sell spot, it would amount to cancellation and not rollover. The cost of cancellation would have been rupees 40,000 only, but the company would have exposed itself to the foreign exchange risk for that extended period of 2 months. So take note of this also, though it is not part of solution, but something important for your understanding. Alright friends, let us proceed ahead with the next upcoming concept, concept number 24, rollover and cancellation before maturity. And again, to understand this concept, let us take up question number 44. Let us read that question first. X Limited purchased an asset for $1 lakh on 1/10/2009. The exchange rate on that date is $1 equals to rupees 44 to rupees 44.60. The amount was to be settled after 3 months, that is on 31/12/2009. On 1/10/2009, the forward rate available was $1 equals to rupees 44 to rupees 45 for 3 months. X Limited entered into this forward exchange contract. On 1/12/2009, X Limited is aware of the fact that it will be unable to make the payment on 31/12/2009 and requires an extension for 2 months, and the expected date of settlement shall be 28/2/2010. X Limited could convince the supplier to accept the delay. Therefore, the company plans for rollover of original contract on 1/12/2009. On 1/12/2009, the forward rate available for 1 month is $1 equals to rupees 44.70 to rupees 45.50, and for 3 months is $1 equals to rupees 45.20 to rupees 45.90. Determine the following action to be taken on 1/12/2009 and net additional cost of rollover. So friends, this question is very much similar to the earlier one that you have solved just now. That was question number 43. There is a difference over here. It is before the maturity itself, X Limited is aware of the fact that it will not be able to honor its contract. That means the cancellation of original contract this time will happen before maturity. And therefore, you know what you have to do. The original contract was to buy US dollar at rupees 45, correct? The original contract was to buy US dollar at 45. The contract to be entered on 1/12/2009 will be to take a reverse position, that is to sell USD. but because you have not arrived at the due date, you still have a month to go for the due date. That means you will enter into a contract to sell USD, but not spot. It will be sell USD 1 month forward. Now, friends, most important thing will be this time you want to extend the contract, and the extension will target a new date of 28 February 2010. So when you look into from 1st December 2009 to 28 February 2010, it will be a gap of 3 months. So the new contract that you should enter into should aim at again buying 1 lakh USD, and for that the forward ask rate is 45.90. So what you are going to do on 1/12/2009, you will enter into not one but two different forward exchange contracts. One is for cancellation of the original contract, and one new contract is for providing the extension. So what would you do for cancelling the original contract? You have to sell dollars at 1 month forward, for which the applicable rate is 44.70. And in the new contract, where you are going to buy 1 lakh US dollar with a 3 month gap from 1/12 to 28 February, it will be a 3 month gap. And because you have to buy dollar, the applicable rate will be the forward ask rate, that is 3 month forward ask rate of 45.90. And just by following the same calculation strategy that you have used earlier, you will be solving this question as well. So let us put up the solution now. In the solution, we would first mention the fact that the original liability as per the forward contract taken on 1/10/2009 was $1 lakh into rupees 45 per dollar, that is rupees 45 lakhs. Further, we would mention on 1/12/2009, the company is aware that it will not be able to honor its forward contract obligation on 31/12/2009. Therefore, it has to take a reverse position, that is entering into a forward contract, that is forward exchange contract, for remaining maturity of original contract, that is for 1 month, to sell $1 lakh, that is sell forward 1 month. The contracted forward rate will be this 44.70 per dollar as the 1 month forward bid rate. So friends, you know these things already, we have discussed. So note down this much before I take you ahead. Alright friends, let us move ahead and write up the solution further. In order to take the new forward cover for buying dollar on 28 February 2010, the company has to enter into another forward contract for 3 months. The contracted forward rate will be rupees 45.90 per dollar. Therefore, on 1/12/2009, the company has 3 unsettled forward exchange contracts as mentioned below. So date of entry, date of settlement, buy or sell, and foreign currency amount. So if you look into one thing, this is the original contract entered into on 1/10/2009. Its expected date of settlement was 31/12/2009, and it was to buy foreign currency amount of US dollar 1 lakh at rate of rupees 45 per dollar. On 1/12/2009, the company has entered into a new forward exchange contract for 1 month to sell dollars 1 lakh, correct? And it has agreed to sell dollars at rupees 44.70 per dollar. Look into one thing. Both of these contracts have the settlement date as same. So what will happen? Buy and sell will cross cancel each other, and your rate of buy and rate of sell, you are buying at 45 and same thing you are selling at 44.70, that differential you will be incurring as a loss, which will be cost of cancellation. So buy, these two contracts will cross cancel each other definitely. So now the new contract that you have entered into on 1/12/2009, which has date of settlement as 28 February 2010, which you have entered into to buy US dollar 1 lakh at 45.90, this is the contract you have entered into for extending your cover period by another 3 months from 1/12/2009. And if you consider the original date of 31/12/2009, the extension is made by 2 months. whatever be the case, you have now agreed to buy $1 lakh at 45.90. Before I make you write the solution ahead, please note down this much first. Alright friends, let us move ahead and write up the calculations ahead. On 31-12-2009, the cross settlement of the first two forward contracts, which were both due on 31-12-2009, will result into a loss of 45 minus 44.70, that is 30 paisa per dollar multiplied by $1 lakh, that will give you a total loss of rupees 30,000. As I mentioned earlier, this rupees 30,000 is basically the cost of cancellation which the company will have to pay on this date itself. The additional cost of rollover will be as below. So first of all, the cost of cancellation comes into picture as this 30,000. You can call this as a loss on cross settlement or the cancellation cost. And then your liability originally was rupees 45 lakhs. With the new forward contract, your liability has increased to 45,90,000. So extra outflow of 90,000 will also result. And finally, the additional cost of rollover will be aggregate of these two figures, that is rupees 1,20,000. So friends, what I am going to do is, I will again give you a note to explain that if the company would have simply paid 30,000, the company would have cancelled the original contract and that's all, correct? 30,000 would have been paid for cancellation of the original contract. This additional 90,000 was basically as per the company's choice. Company could have avoided this 90,000 by simply not taking the new forward cover of this payable. But doing so, what would have happened? Company's outflow from pocket would have been only 30,000, that is towards cancellation. But then from 1st December 2009, until the payment is settled, that is on 28 February 2010, for all that period, the company would have exposed itself to foreign exchange risk. And what would have happened? Sometimes, instead of 90,000, company might have, you know, paid even a bigger sum to settle its liability. Because in that case, the company agrees to buy $1 lakh at whatever spot rate that will be prevailing on 28 February 2010. Here, by entering into this arrangement, at least company is aware of the fact that no matter what happens, it will pay rupees 45,90,000 on its final settlement. Therefore, this additional cost of rollover is 1,20,000. First, do one thing, note down this, and then I'll give you that explanatory note also. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this. So write up that explanatory note also. I have explained you already, just note it down. Finish writing this and that will be end of the solution. Alright friends, let us move ahead and take up another upcoming question, that is question number 45. Now this question reads as, a customer with whom the bank had entered into 3-month forward purchase contract for Swiss franc 10,000 at the rate of 27.25, that is rupees 27.25, comes to bank after 2 months and requests cancellation of the contract. On this date, the rates prevailing are spot CHF 1 equals to rupees 27.30 to 27.35 and 1 month forward CHF 1 equals to rupees 27.45 to rupees 27.52. What is the loss or gain to the customer on cancellation? So friends, this is very simple question, but don't enter into a trap. Look into the first line. A customer with whom the bank had entered into 3-month forward purchase contract. That means the first line indicates from the bank's viewpoint that it is a 3-month forward purchase contract. Means basically the customer has entered into a contract to sell. If the customer wants to cancel the contract, the customer will have to take a reverse position, that is now to buy CHF, correct? So original contract from the customer's viewpoint was to sell 10,000 Swiss francs. To cancel, the customer has to buy 10,000 Swiss francs. The original contract was 3 months forward, and the customer approaches to the bank for cancellation after 2 months. That means there is yet 1 month remaining maturity for the original contract. So this spot rate is not relevant at all, because the customer has to buy Swiss franc, the rate applicable for cancellation will be the 1 month forward ask rate. And why 1 month forward? Because the original contract was for 3 months forward, and it is only after 2 months from the date of entering that the customer wants to cancel the contract. So we can easily work out the amount of gain or loss to customer on cancellation. So let us see how to present the solution. In the solution, you first mention the fact that the bank has entered into a forward purchase contract with customer. That means the customer has entered into a forward contract to sell CHF 10,000 at the rate of rupees 27.25 per CHF. The customer is willing to cancel the original forward contract 1 month before the maturity. The customer has to take reverse position for remaining maturity. Therefore, the customer must enter into a new forward contract, that is buy forward CHF 10,000 at the rate of rupees 27.52 per CHF, and that would be 1 month forward. So friends, as I have mentioned in the question, rupees 27.52 was given as 1 month forward ask rate, that is the date on which the customer has approached for cancellation. So finally, look into this is the contracted rate at which customer has agreed to sell, and the same thing at this rate the customer has agreed to buy. Finally, what you would find difference between the two as loss to the customer, which is rupees 2700. So take note of this, and that will be end of the solution. We start with question number 51, a very simple basic question, but highlighting this concept of interbank rates and margins. So let us read this question. On 1/12/2017, a bank dealing in foreign exchange in Mumbai observes the interbank rate of USD as USD 1 equals to INR 64.1160 to INR 64.1280. The bank applies margin of 0.2% over the interbank rate. Determine the following. Number 1, exchange rate quoted by the bank to its customer. And second thing, amount payable by a customer to bank for buying USD 10,000 from the bank. And third, amount obtained by customer from bank on selling USD 16,000 to bank. Now friends, before we start solving the question, what we do is we try to understand what all is informed. So in this case, this is the interbank rate that the bank observes, which is quoted in the forex market. That means this rate is not quoted by bank for its customer. This is the rate which is identified as interbank rate. This is the rate at which bank will buy and sell currency from other bank, or you can say forex market. Now, the exchange rate quoted by bank to its customer has to be determined. And now what you are going to do, for the bank you are going to consider margin of 0.2%. Obviously 0.2% will be a common rate for bid as well as ask, because separate rates for bid and ask have not been given. That means the margin is common for bid as well as ask. So this is the wholesale bid rate on which you apply 0.2%, which will become margin for the bank. To arrive at the retail bid rate, which the bank will quote to its customer, you are going to subtract margin from this bid rate, and while arriving at the retail ask rate, you are going to add 0.2% margin to this interbank ask rate. So friends, this is what you are going to do. In simple words, I would say, this being a wholesale rate, look into the spread involved over here, and you will observe the spread involved in the retail rate that you come up with, and that will have a larger spread as compared to this rate. Second important thing, Do you notice that these are values quoted in four places after decimal? This being interbank rate, it is fine. But as far as bank quoting a rate to its customer, it should be in two places after decimal. That is the style of quoting the exchange rates. So let us begin with the solution. So in the solution, what you first do is interbank bid rate INR per USD, and from that we are subtracting the margin of 0.2%, and what we get is the retail bid rate, correct? 63.9878, and this will be generally rounded off to just two places after decimal, that is 63.99 per dollar. Now you talk about the ask rate, that is interbank ask rate, which is informed as 64.1280. Add margin, being ask rate, you are going to add margin, and that will be 0.1283. And when you finally arrive at the calculation, it is 64.2563, which will be rounded off to 64.26. Therefore, exchange rate quoted by bank to customer will be, now see, this is the style of rate quoted by bank to the ultimate customer. So $1 equals to 63.99 to 64.26. Look into one thing, the spread involved in this quote is much higher than the spread that we have observed in the interbank rate. So friends, what you do is write up this whole thing and then I take you ahead in the solution. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Now let us do one thing. Solving second and third part of the question is very simple once you arrive at this exchange rate quoted by bank to its customer. So in the second part, what is being asked? Amount payable by a customer to bank for buying USD 10,000 from bank. Now what will be this amount? Obviously, the customer will consider the ask rate, correct? The ask rate that we have obtained, that will be applied on $10,000, and that was 64.26 per dollar. $10,000 into rupees 64.26 per dollar will give you rupees 6,42,600. That's the amount payable by customer for buying $10,000 from bank. And amount obtained by customer from bank on selling USD 16,000 to bank, it will be 16,000 multiplied by the bid rate. So it is $16,000 multiplied by rupees 63.99 per dollar, and what you get is rupees 10,23,840. So note down this as well, and that will be end of the solution. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Let us move ahead and take up more questions dealing with interbank rates and margins. A very important question, that is question number 52. One of the favorite questions of ICAI. Lot many times the same question has been asked in CA final examination. So how this goes? On January 28, 2013, an importer customer requested a bank to remit Singapore dollar, that is SGD 25 lakh, under an irrevocable letter of credit. However, due to unavoidable factors, the bank could effect remittances only on February 4, 2013. Interbank market rates were as follows. So they have given rates for January 28, 2013 and February 4, 2013. The bank wishes to retain an exchange margin of 0.125%. required. How much does the customer stand to gain or lose due to the delay? And lastly, a note is given to you, calculate the rate in multiples of 0.0001. That means with this specification, what we generally do, the retail rate which is applicable for the ultimate customer, we generally round it off in two places after decimal. With this limitation given, you are not supposed to round off that rate in two places after decimal. Now, what we observe from the rates given, quote of dollar is given in terms of rupees, quote of GBP is given in terms of US dollar, and quote of GBP is also given in terms of Singapore dollar. Now, the point is, the transaction is going to be effected by converting Indian rupee into Singapore dollar. But do you notice one thing, that there is no quote available with respect to Singapore dollar in terms of Indian rupee. That means through these rates, we'll have to make a cross currency calculation and arrive at the retail rate for the customer that will be applicable for January 28, as well as another rate which will be applicable for February 4. Obviously, the rates will be different, and as a result, on the remittance of 25 lakh Singapore dollars, there will be a difference which the customer will have to face, and that difference will be either a gain or loss for the customer, and that is what we have to calculate. So let us do one thing, let us see how to present the solution. In the solution, you are first going to get started with the cross currency calculation. That will be INR per SGD, will be INR per USD into USD per GBP into GBP per SGD. Now understand one thing very well, what will happen? You would want to determine INR per SGD, and your interest is in determining the ask rate only, because the customer has to remit Singapore dollars. That means the customer has to buy Singapore dollars. If the customer has to buy Singapore dollar, the applicable rate will be obviously ask rate. So what we have learnt in any cross currency calculation, ask rate should always be multiplied to ask rates when you are determining the ask rate. As a result, you would want INR per USD ask rate, USD per GBP ask rate, and GBP per SGD ask rate. Look into one thing, what is given with respect to rates on 28th January 2013. INR per USD directly given as 45.90 as ask rate, USD per GBP directly given as 1.7850 as ask rate. Now, GBP per SGD wasn't given. What was given was SGD per GBP. So you have to take the inverse, and when you take the inverse, you know one thing, what happens? Inverse of bid rate will become ask rate, correct? So 3.1575 was indeed a bid rate. When you took the inverse, it becomes the ask rate. So all ask rates getting multiplied, finally cross rate for INR per SGD, what you get is 25.9482. mind one more thing, this rate is still an interbank rate. Why? Because we have not adjusted the margins till now. So we will make one more calculation like this on 4th February 2013. Exactly same calculation, same way, only the rates what we have adopted are the rates prevailing on 4th February 2013. So friends, do one thing, write up this whole thing and then I take you ahead. Alright friends, you would have written this. Let us move ahead. And now, once we have arrived at the interbank ask rates for both of these dates, we are going to adjust margins, arrive at the rate applicable to the ultimate customer, and then look into what has happened with respect to gain or loss to the customer. So, amount of expected outflow. If the remittance was effected on 28th January 2013, the interbank ask rate for SGD was what we have just computed, 25.9482 per SGD, and to that you add margin. Don't forget, being calculation of ask rate, you are going to add margins for arriving at the retail ask rate, correct? So the retail ask rate or effective ask rate for the customer will be ₹25.9806. Now one more thing again, we would have rounded off this to just ₹25.98 only, but because the question has emphasized to take four places after decimal, we are doing that. So write up this as well and then I take you ahead. Alright friends, let us move ahead. and make a similar calculation for the next date, that was 4th February 2013. And if the remittance was effected on that later date, we again do the same thing, interbank ask rate for SGD on that date, add margin, and what we get is the effective ask rate for the customer. Now what we find is the rates on 4th February has slightly increased. As a result, there will be a loss to the customer due to delay in remittance, and that will be the effective rate for 4th February minus effective rate for 28th January. That differential multiplied by 25 lakh Singapore dollars, and what you get is total loss to customer in terms of rupee value will be rupees 2,28,250. So note down this as well, and that will be end of the solution. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Let us move ahead and take up another important question, that is question number 53. What is given over here? An importer requests his bank to extend the forward contract for US$20,000, which is due for maturity on 30th October 2010 for a further period of 3 months. He agrees to pay the required margin money for such extension of the contract, and the contracted rate is US$1 equals to rupees 42.32. The US dollar quoted on 30th October 2010 spot given as 41.5000 to 41.5200. Now friends, rate given in four places after decimal clearly indicates that this is an interbank spot rate, correct? And then 3 months premium given to you. This time premium is not given in the form of swap points or forward points. Premium is given in the form of percentage. Doesn't matter, we will be applying these percentages, that is 0.87% to the spot bid rate and 0.93% to the spot ask rate. All right. Margin money for buying and selling rate is 0.075% and 0.2% respectively. That means these are the margins to be applied on the interbank rate to arrive at the rate that the bank should quote to its customer. And then they say compute the cost to the importer in respect of the extension of the forward contract and the rate of new forward contract. So first of all, what is the scenario? The customer has been an importer over here, correct? And this importer has requested and contracted earlier to buy US dollar from bank at this contracted rate and now wants an extension of 3 months. So first of all, your old contract needs to get cancelled and a new contract should come into picture. So you have initially agreed to buy dollars at 42.32. Now you should sell dollars to cross or to, you know, square off this position. So you will have to arrive at a rate at which you can sell dollars, correct? So you want to cancel the contract, you will sell spot on the maturity date to cancel this original forward contract. For that purpose, the spot bid rate will be taken as interbank rate, adjust margin which is given as 0.075%, and you will be obtaining a rate applicable for the customer to cancel the contract. Once the old contract is cancelled, now the customer still has a need to buy $20,000, and for that purpose the spot ask rate, which is interbank rate, it is informed to you. The premium part for the ask rate, 0.93%, will be adjusted. Once that is done, you arrive at interbank forward ask rate. Then you add margin for the banker and arrive at the rate applicable to the ultimate customer. So let us see how to present the whole solution. The contract is to be cancelled on 30th October 2010 at spot bid rate of US$1 equals to rupees 41.5000, but this being an interbank rate, you will adjust the margin. So spot bid rate and less margin, don't forget over here, you are subtracting margin because it is a bid rate, correct? Now, after subtracting, whatever you get will be rounded off in two places after decimal. So, customer has originally agreed to buy dollars at what rate? 42.32. Now, to cancel the contract, customer has to sell dollars at 41.47. Finally, difference between these two rates multiplied by $20,000 will give you the cost to the importer for cancellation, that is rupees 17,000. What I want from you is take note of this whole thing and then we move ahead. Alright friends, you would have finished writing this whole thing. Let us move ahead and deal with the remaining part of the solution where we have a need to determine the new rate applicable for the customer for buying dollars 3 months after. So, the new forward rate will be determined by taking the spot ask rate on USD1, that is on 30th October, correct? Which is given as 41.5200. Now, this is first of all an interbank spot ask rate. What we do first of all is add premium to arrive at the forward rate. So, what we get now is interbank forward ask rate for US dollar 1, and that is 41.9061. And then what you do is add margin for the bank. We are adding margin because this is an ask rate, and what we get is 41.9899, which will be rounded off to 41.99. So the new rate applicable for the customer for buying dollars 3 months after the date of cancellation will be rupees 41.99 per dollar. So friends, note down this as well, and that will be end of the solution.